Hey everybody, it's your girl Bunny, Queen Sugar, season 4, episode 12 here. There's only one episode left, and I'm so happy to say that my reviews for this season have been pretty much on point, and don't worry, I have plenty of receipts. For the new subscribers, keep in mind that I actually recap and review as I go along, discussing tonight's episode. That's all coming up next. First scene, we have Ralph Angel in blue. They're in his room and they're getting rid of clothes that don't fit anymore. They're putting things away. And Ralph Angel explains, hey, we're doing spring cleaning. You need to try things on, see if they fit anymore. And if they don't, we're gonna give them away. And Blue says, okay, so he goes to another room and we can guess that he's going to the restroom, I guess, to try on clothes or to put things away. And Ralph Angel looks into a closet and there is a top shelf. And he discovers a present that was never opened. Blue never opened it. And he reads the card, and it's to Blue. It's for Blue from his grandfather, so Ralph Angel's father. And he's really perplexed, and you can kind of tell that, should I be excited? Should I remind Blue about this present? He's excited and saddened at the same time. And you can kind of see the conflict there. Wow, do I introduce this to Blue? Do I not? And we see that he puts it back at the top of the shelf and wants to sit that in the back of the brain for a while. As he's doing that, Blue comes back into the room and he hears someone in the driveway and notices that it's Nova. So Ralph Angel's still not having it. He's still upset with Nova, and he tells Blue to stay in the house while he goes to talk to her. And Blue's really confused, like, well, why can't I go out and see, you know, Auntie Nova? It's been a while, I haven't seen her. He's like, she's got a cold, you know, I don't want you around her, you know, boom. So Blue behaves and, you know, listens to his dad, and he goes outside to see Nova, and Nova's getting out the car, and he's just looking at her like, wow, the nerve. Now you coming up in here. So she gets out of the car, and Ralph Angel says, you know, like, well, hello, like, I'm surprised to see you here, and, oh, you know, what is it that you need? And Nova says, you know, I really have to tell you something. And he's like, oh, what other bomb are you gonna drop? You know, you dropped the bomb that, you know, I guess we're related to the Bordelones now. What else could you possibly tell me, you know? And she's telling him, look, you can't stay mad at me forever. And he like, I can, you know, like, yes. And he's not ready to talk to her. So she gets in her car and skedaddles. We then see Charlie and Micah. They're at home, and she's decorating the place with decorations and balloons. And she has a nice Harvard sweater on, and she's just so proud and excited for Micah. And Micah just, he really didn't look too excited. He's like, yay, Harvard. You know, everybody else would be like, I'm going to Harvard, and just so excited and happy about it. And he's just like, doesn't even seem like he's about to leave for Harvard. Now, as I mentioned in the last review, I did say that Micah didn't seem like he wanted to go to that school of choice, or at least not to the school that his mother wanted him to, that we must look into the writers and them explaining that we can't have this cookie cutter idea of what kids should do in their journey and what makes them happy. It was kind of like he was just kind of build a bear situation, that he was in the best schools, the best education, but is that what Michael wanted? Because in the last episode, a lot of his friends were discussing what they wanted and their dreams, and he was just really confused and lost about what he wanted to do, because we forget that their happiness is important. And I don't think he had that talk with his parents, with his family, about what really satisfied him inside as far as a career. Cut to Nova, and she's on her couch, and she's reading books, and she's doing research, and she has this epiphany as she's reading, and you could tell she calls a friend that's maybe a journalist or a researcher, and she says, hey, you know, look up this name for me. Parker Campbell. Can you look that up? It's with Old World Energy. And they say, okay, I'll look into it. And she hears a knock at the door. She goes to the door and it is Aunt Vine. She's just like, oh, you know, hey, I'm happy that you're here, but we haven't talked and I've been calling you and you've been ignoring me. And then all of a sudden you pop up basically like, what is this about? And Vi says, look, I got to know the address to Jimmy Dale's home and I've got to know and I've got to give this to him. And she has this box and we don't know what's in the box. We've seen glimpses about what's in the box. We see that there is a hospital wristband in there, some old photos, and she's looked through this box before in other episodes and we've only seen snippets. So Nova's concerned and she's just like, I would help you, but I don't want you going there, and I especially don't want you going there alone. She's worried, just like anybody else should be worried, that this could end in violence. This could end very badly, and I'm not going to give you his address. And Vi's like, look, this is about me. You opened the door to all of these demons I had in the past, and this is something for me. This is something that I need. So I need you to give me Jimmy Dale's address. I got to go over there. I got some things on my chest. I got to give this to him. And Nova's like, okay, look, I can give you the address, I can help you out, but only if I drive, only if I take you, and if we talk. And Vi says, basically baby steps, okay, you can take me there and you can drive, but as far as talking to you, I'll do that when I'm ready. We got Charlie and Prosper, they're at the volunteer site, and they're looking at replays on the news of Jacob Bordelon and him revealing his new genealogy and what he's learned. And they see that his points have fallen and his support is fallen. And Charlie sees this as a good thing. And Prosper says, you know what? I hate to burst your bubble, and I was going to mention this later, but there's been some problems with the voting. He explains, when I went to go vote, they were telling me that I'm not even a resident and I've lived here my whole life. And not just me, several other people are having this issue. And I've even heard that when people went to go vote, the poll was moved. So this is a big thing. And so it seems like they've been pushed 10 steps back. In the midst of them discussing that, we have Frances Landry. She walks in and it seems like she was a ghost and just like barged her way in. And Charlie's like, well, hello, welcome, you know, come in. And she tells Prosper, you know, can we have a moment? And he just stands there and freezes. And Charlie says, oh, it's okay. I'll make it quick. So he steps outside and she says to Charlie, you know, wow, what did you tell my son? What nerve of you to just believe some type of genealogy that's come from who knows where? And do you even know what you're doing? And Charlie says, look, I gave him the information and it's not my fault that your genealogy is the way that it is. So, you know, why get upset with me? I mentioned in the last review that this information that they have can't be trustworthy. They just got it randomly. They didn't question it. They didn't do any research, really. I mean, Nova says she looked at it and did some digging, but did she really? And where did she get the information from? And how do we know that this is 100% true? I mentioned that, and I also predicted that in the end, this so-called genealogy and this information will backfire. In the midst of her and Charlie talking, we have some police officers along with Prosper, and he says, look, I hate to interrupt you guys, but these police officers want to speak with Charlie. And of course, you know, we have Miss Landry. She says, well, I see that you're busy, so I'll let you get to it. Charlie says to the police officers, look, I'm glad that y'all are here because I've been calling y'all over and over again, waiting on an update about my meal, about this situation, and, you know, just wondering what the update is. And the police officers say, we've been, you know, doing, you know, interviews, and we've been investigating, and we're putting two and two together, making sure that we're dotting our I's and crossing our T's on everything. So we're here to talk to you. And Charlie says, well, okay. So they asked her questions insinuating that the fire was off arson on her behalf. They tell her that, you know, we looked more into it and we saw that the fire was caused by a propane drift torch. And a propane drift torch is used to do controlled fires with sugarcane. So Charlie's looking at them like, okay. And they said, well, your brother owns, you know, the sugarcane field, right? And she's like, well, yeah, you know that, but what are you getting at? And they're like, well, also, is it a lot of money to kind of keep the mill going, and is it expensive? And she says, well, pretty much the same expenses as everybody else, and this is a newer factory, so yeah. And they say, well, is it hard to maintain and is it too much? And she says, well, okay, time out. Look, I'm wealthy, so there's no need for me to burn it down. I got money, so throw that idea out. Have you even looked at the border loans? Have you even looked at anybody else to investigate if they have anything to do with this? And they're like, we don't have any proof that they have anything to do with this. And Charlie's just giving them this look like, okay, wow. And then they also bring up, well, your son also, I mean, he was in another case to where he had a case to where he was convicted of arson. Isn't that correct? And Charlie says, you know what? That's enough of the questions. Y'all can get out. If y'all want to talk to me again, it's going to be me with the lawyer. So we got Vi and we got Nova. They're on their way to Jimmy Dale's house. And Vi says, you know what? You told the wrong story. You only told, look, I counted the pages. You had more negative pages than you had positive pages. But there should have been more about my victory, about my triumph. You only told the part of the story of me that was worse. You didn't express that I got out of that situation, that I got my own business, that I'm in love, that I'm happy. Like, why didn't you write more about that? And, you know, of course, Nova, she's just like, I'm realizing that. And you're right. Okay, yeah. Like, you have crushed so many lives by exposing their truth. But Vi tells her that if you wanted to write something, you could have come to me to get my full story. But it hurt her that she put so much of the negatives of her life story in this book. And she didn't feel like there was enough positive energy about Vi since she had been through so much. That's really what hurt her the most. I don't even think it was really just the secret of releasing her domestic violence story in the book, but the fact that it was left that she only came out of it and that was it. She came out of it and did so much more. So Vi is finally letting her know, again, you hurt me because you didn't put enough of my victory in the book. Ralph Angel, Blue, and Darla, they're all at the house, and Darla and Blue are in the backyard. They're running around, playing with a Frisbee, just having a wonderful time. They come back in. Blue is still, I think, outside or in another room, and Darla is speaking with Ralph Angel, and he shares with her that he found this present that was from his dad that was meant for Blue, and he never got to open it. So Darla is just like, wow, you know, are you going to share this with him, and have you? And he's just like, basically, I don't know how, but he planned on it. He also told her that Nova came by, and you see Darla conflicted, like, ugh, even the sound of her name just has Darla just kind of flushed. And he said she came by and, you know, said that she had something to tell me, and ain't no telling what it is, but she needs to tell me. I don't care. And I didn't even let Blue see her. And she pauses, and you could tell she kind of checks herself because she immediately thinks about Blue. And she's like, look, I'm upset with her. She's done hurtful things with me. She's hurt you. But Nova loves Blue, and she has every right to be around him, and kind of like, hey, we got to be selfless in this situation because Blue deserves as much love as possible. And Ralph Angel says, you know, that's all fine and dandy, and, you know, I'll consider him talking to her, but I'm not ready yet. We get to Jimmy Dale's house. You got Vi and you got Nova, and Vi tells Nova, look, stay in here, you know, basically like, this is something that I need to do. Stay in the vehicle. I got this. So Vi gets out, and you know, Nova, you know, she's following her. She's giving her the space, but she's kind of like, let me follow close just in case something happens. Vi, she's holding the box with all those old memories. She's knocking at the door. Jimmy Dale opens it, and of course he has this energy of, I knew you couldn't stay away. Where you been? And she's just like, look, I wanted to give this to you. He opens it. He recognizes some of the stuff, and he's just like, so what is this supposed to get a reaction out of me? And Vi says, look, I wanted to give you this because for so long I was holding all of these memories. I was holding on to this, but you need to carry the burden, and you need to live and deal with what you did to me. You need to deal with the contents of this box. And he says, well, look, you coming here, clearly you seeking me, is something that you want with me, kind of like gloating, like you just want to be around me, like you can't just help to come around me. Listening to him rant, Vi is mustering up so much courage to speak and stand in her foundation of her feet on that ground so hard, because as she's talking and defending herself, she's mumbling over her words and she's stuttering, and you can tell she's afraid, and she's trying so hard to let him know how she feels, because these are emotions and this is trauma that she's held on to for so many years. And she says, I'm moving on, I'm great, and I'm happy. And Nova slowly comes up the stairs and holds her hand and gives a firm hold, like, you know, kind of telepathy, using that body language, saying, okay, come on, that's enough, let's go. And still we got Jimmy Dale just saying all kinds of stuff and just kind of trying to break her down like he used to. And she kind of pulls her away, and Vi gives that chin up, like, I said what I had to say and let me get out of here. In the midst of her walking downstairs, Jimmy Dale throws down the box and it just breaks, and Vi gives this scream as if she's living in the past. All of a sudden she reflects that, you know what, I'm sick of this. She turns around, she looks at his house and says, this is all you have. You have your terrible words and you have this old house. That's all you got. But you know what? I have a business. I got money. I have love. I won, basically. I'm living that life, and you're upset because you don't have that. And it's just like this flush of woosah, that she finds this comfort in finally getting it out and finally having that understanding to where, I didn't fail. I overcame. I kept going. I gave love another chance. I moved on with my life. Might not have been perfect, but I got over that hurdle of being with you and dealing with that trauma. And she gives this deep sigh, like, and she walks to the vehicle, and as she's walking to the vehicle, she sees a girl. She has a bandage on her forehead and she's holding groceries, and she's just like, oh, Jimmy, I didn't know you had company, you know, and plus they were taking too long at the store. And Vi knows exactly what's going on. Clearly this is somebody that's involved with Jimmy Dale, and she looks really young. And Vi says, look, I see myself in you from years ago. You don't have to go back into that house. You can make the decision now that this is it. This is the last day. And Jimmy Dale is trying to intervene and talk over. And Vi says, you know, basically, look at me. Listen to me. You can get out of this situation right now. I noticed the bandage on your face. I see the hurt. I see the fear that you have. You have the opportunity to leave. And we hear that her name is Layla, because Jimmy Dale is screaming her name, you know, Layla, get in this house. And she says, I don't have anywhere else to go. And Vi says, I know a place. I know where I can take you, and I can take you there right now. And you just have to say yes, and we can go. And she says, well, what if he finds me? She says, if he finds you, he finds me. And I'm gonna make sure that you're okay. And she says, I just need you to drop that bag and leave with me right now. And the girl she drops the bag, she turns around, and they get her in the truck, and they drive off. It's that moment to where Vi has that peace of knowing that she's helped not only Layla, but a version and a point of helping her own self. The image of how she wasn't able to help herself in the past. Kiki and Micah, they have that talk about going to school, and they just realize, like, wow, you know, we're becoming adults, and with school, you know, we probably won't be able to see each other that much. And before they get into that deep conversation, they are at a photography display, and they're looking at all of these photos, and he's just like, wow, look at this photo, and look at this, and oh, and check out this one. This photo is one that was retrieved from Katrina. The images were dried out, and they tried to save the image, and there's still something there. So it symbolizes that hope, it symbolizes moving forward, and it's just, the image is still vivid. It's blurry, but it's vivid. And Kiki says, wow, you know, you really explain photography well, and you really grasp it, and you see how Micah's face lights up when he talks about it. But you could tell that he's slowly learning, wow, this is something that I might wanna do. And I said in the last review that Micah was unsure of himself. He had an idea of what others wanted him to be, more specifically what his mother wanted him to do, but he has this light of happiness talking about photography. Layla is taken to a domestic abuse center by Nova and Vi, and they're telling the staff, hey, take good care of her, you know, and they're telling Layla everything's gonna be okay, and Vi is telling her, this is the beginning of making things new. This is your chance to make that decision to move forward. And when you're ready, you'll have a job at Vi's Prize Pies. And she tells the staff, you know, call me. If she tries to leave, you call me. Once again, Vi finds this inner peace because it's like not only is she helping Layla, but she's helping her previous self. So this gives her that final stamp of done, or at least beginning the stages of evolving out of this trauma that she experienced from her previous marriage. Darla is at Vi's restaurant, and it looks like she's buying a nice pie, and she sees Vi walk up to the counter, and Darla says, you know, thank you for everything. You were with me at my weakest point, and you helped me realize what I needed to do, and I just thank you for that. And Vi says, look, we haven't always been on the best of terms, but I want the best for you, and basically I wish you all the best. Darla says, I don't have much, but I want to tell you thank you. This is a 1 month sobriety chip, and besides Blue being the greatest thing of my life and the best achievement, this is the second thing, and I want you to have it. I used to have a lot of these because, remember, she was 3 years sober, so of course she's starting over again at the first month, and she gives it to Vi, and Vi holds it in her hand as she holds Darla's hand, and she's just like, wow. You know, and you can make a good guess that Vi probably, she's probably not gonna take that, but she holds her hand as a good gesture, because knowing Vi, she probably wants her to keep that because that's her accomplishment. That's something for her to hold on to. Charlie tells the volunteers for the campaign that people are playing dirty. They're changing the poll locations. They're saying that a lot of people aren't residents when they are. We're gonna have to pull together more than ever to support and give support and information if things change. And Prosper says, we have a phone chain going. We need to communicate with as many people as we can, maybe transport them to the polls where we know they are. Kind of like not playing this game and not, you know, just taking a loss. We're at least gonna try and not go with their sneakiness, and we're gonna try to get as many people to vote as possible, even though that we know they're playing dirty. So after that scene, we cut to the family. They're at Charlie's house, and they are about to celebrate Micah's acceptance into Harvard. And Nova pulls Charlie to the side and tells her, look, this company, Old World Energy, that name that I had connected with that company is just not coming up. And there's this other company that popped up. I think she said Berkeley or Beckley. That's something we haven't been able to track down. It's like they're a ghost. It's like they don't even exist. I had somebody look into it, and it's a small little company and just has one front desk receptionist. So it's really fishy. It sounds like, of course, a fabricated company that doesn't exist, because if you go to a Fortune 500 company, they're not going to be in this small little suite with one desk and one receptionist. It's very clear that this is a cover-up company, not only for tax evasion, but really just going ghostly, going in blind. A lot of companies, just side note, a lot of companies have been discovered with tax evasion and fraud, making up fake addresses, making up fake locations. So when it comes to taxes, when it comes to land, anything like that, that they can't be found. So Charlie says, wow, this is something bigger than the Landrys. Duh, Mr. Landry told Vi and Charlie that it was bigger than him. There are companies that you wouldn't even dream of that are playing this game. It's the money game. It's the old money game. And so now Charlie is finally seeing that it's bigger than what she thinks. The final scene. We have the family. They are in the living room. Everybody has their gifts and balloons, and you could tell there's some snacks, and everybody's just so happy for Micah. And Charlie, she has a special bag and gives it to Micah, and Micah opens it up, and it is a box, and it is a Rolex. Ooh, I would love to have a Rolex, okay? He opens it up, and he's looking at it like, okay, wow, thanks. You know, anybody else would have probably fainted, but anywho. And everybody's like, yeah, you know, that's so good. Congratulations, everybody's smiling. And everybody else is smiling, but Micah's in this very dark place. And he's just very discouraged that everybody else is having a good time but him. And he's starting to get teary-eyed. And he stands up and he was like, Mom, I was going to wait until after the race, but I'm going to go ahead and tell you this now. I'm not going to Harvard. I discovered that I really want to study photography and politics and all of the things that help people and grow and develop people. And Charlie has this look as if she's been slapped in the face. She is so thrown off by it. And she says, Micah, you have been given a winning hand. Why wouldn't you want to go to Harvard? And he's like, you know, I understand that, but you inspired me more than anybody. You inspired me to say, do what makes the community happy and helping people. And I love photography and I want to enroll at Xavier. And she looks at Nova, and Nova like, well, he ain't tell me nothing. I didn't know. I'm this first time I'm hearing this. And then she look at Kiki, and Kiki's like, this the first time I'm hearing it. Cause she just like, who's responsible, okay, for making Micah change his mind and going to Harvard? But he's just like, look, this was my decision and I'm going for it. And she's just like, well, I mean, we've already sent it off to Harvard. And he's just like, well, no, I actually sent it to Xavier and I told Harvard what was up. So this is where I'm going. When I tell you Charlie was hurt, she was hurt because she's been through so much in her own life. And she says, you want to go into photography and you want to start this stuff, but Harvard's going to tell you how to be an entrepreneur. Harvard's going to tell you how to compete with people such as the Landrys. You're going to have that name of Harvard on your back, and you're just going to let it go? And Micah, and the gentleman that plays Micah in those puppy dog eyes, and he just, when they fill with tears, I'm just like, oh, Micah. And he's just so hurt. Instead of getting that support of, okay, that's what my son wants to do, and I support his journey, she's pissed off. So Vi, she stands up and she says, well, I'm actually happy that you'll be closer to home, and basically I wish you all the best. And Charlie is still pissed off. She says, after everything you've been through, after everything I've been through, you talk about you want to help the people, you want to help the community, you go to Harvard. You don't go to Xavier. And, you know, we got Nova. Well, you know, Xavier is a good school. It's a wonderful HBCU, you know. And Charlie, she has that look like, I'm new. I know you ain't trying to chime in on this. And I was really thinking Charlie was going to turn around and bop her upside the head, but she kept it together. But Charlie was upset. Everybody else was just kind of like, uh-oh, they airing this out now. We supposed to be celebrating. She wasn't having it. She left the room. She was just, she was just everything that's going on. She was just done. Like, oh, this is happening, and I'm done. She just walked out. Micah just sits down completely defeated. Completely defeated. And that was the end of the episode. Now, I'm sticking to my guns, you guys. I do think still the information that was supposed to be their ammunition will backfire, unfortunately. I still feel that way. I still feel that way about Charlie in this race. Let's say hypothetically she does win the race. She will now be in the dirty money gang of America. She will learn she is not at the table of decision making. She's another pawn for the rich. If she gets in, she will be the face for the minorities. She's getting in the world that she has no clue how it works, which is being deceitful, which is lying, which is lying to the people and obtaining money. And once she's in it, she's gonna be knee deep in it. Very highly unlikely that they're gonna end the last episode with a victory and tears of joy. Highly unlikely. That's what's keeping the show rolling. You want to have season 5 be the kaboom of what's next. You gotta have the connection point from season 4 to season 5 to keep you hungry, to where after episode 13, we're gonna be like, that's it? Oh, they ending it like this? That's how you have to do television. That's how you keep people connected with the show. If it's just a Disney ending, we're still left with unanswered questions. So I hope you liked this review/recap. And with all of the other reviews, since there's so much more information, if you have not looked at all the reviews, I encourage you to go back and look at all of my predictions, because they have been on point and they have been exact and almost to a T. The only thing that we haven't looped around back to is Hollywood and Vi's relationship. Now, I did say that Vi was pushing Hollywood away, and that I really thought that Hollywood would finally reach his breaking point. I still think that's possible. Even though Vi has had her epiphany in dealing with the trauma, she has yet, this whole time, to consider, wow, majority of our money has gone to my business. Majority of our time has gone into development of me. Even though that's being a good husband from Hollywood's perspective, this man is running on a tank of empty. He has gave to Vi. And it was only till recently where Vi took some time out to kind of cater to him and say, baby, what do you want? I hope my prediction is incorrect for season 5, but that would be a big jaw dropper if Hollywood says, you know what, I'm so worn out and tired. What about me? What about what I want? And I think that moment is coming, because he may be up to his boiling point in dealing with a lot of stuff and not saying, baby, what do you want? Because remember, Hollywood had those dreams of the barbershop, you know, buying a barbershop. He wanted to buy some rigs. It was a whole bunch of stuff he wanted to do. And you know what? Vi forgot about that dream just like the viewers did. We forgot about what he really wanted to do. Because remember, he had this list of things that he wanted to do. And everything that he thought of, oh, baby, don't do that. Oh, no, don't do this. Oh, no, baby, don't do that. But when it came to her dreams, when it came to what she wanted, he made it happen right on the dot. And foreshadowing with that, when Hollywood last spoke to his mother, I hope you all remember this. When Hollywood spoke to his mother, it was either the beginning of season four, at the end of season three. It was a little bit around that time before Hollywood and Vi got married. She says, I know that you love Vi, but you've forgotten your dreams. Please don't forget your dreams. Don't get so caught up in what Vi wants and forget who you are. That was writing foreshadowing, and a lot of viewers have forgotten that because it was so long ago. So if that happens with Hollywood, it's going to be a boom to the viewers because we're like, man, where did that come from? I never thought that would be their relationship. Highly likely. If it doesn't happen, great, because, I mean, I don't want anything to, you know, mess up their relationship. I love Vi and Hollywood together. But it is possible and it is plausible that that will happen. Let me know what you think. What did you think about this episode? Only one episode left. I'm so excited. Make sure to check out the video where I talk about this fall, all of the shows that are coming up, because The Handmaid's Tale has ended, Pose has ended. All lineup of all of the shows that are coming up. We have The Watchmen, we have Greenleaf, we have Wu-Tang and American Saga. Check that video out and see what I'm reviewing next. Comment, subscribe, hit that notification bell so you don't miss any posts, and follow me on Instagram, officialbun_e. Bye. Woo, woo, that's how some of that proceeds. He doesn't really know what he wants to do or where he wants to go. He is a whirling dervish. He has no idea what he wants to do with his life. Everybody else can see where they want to be, but him. He's lived at the best house, been in the best city, been at the best schools. This is why I say the scene is very deep. With millennials, with these generations that are behind us, is college for everybody? That might not have been what the writers intended, but this was my point of view. Is college the default to a lot of people that don't know what they want to do with their lives? Now, don't get me wrong, education is very important, but a lot of people forget that there's different ways of learning and developing your craft and learning who you are. So even though you've gotten into Harvard, who are you? He still doesn't know who he is, where his true talents lie, and if he has an idea for a career or development, is he shy or hesitant to share what that is? He's conflicted with different traumas that he's dealt with. He's had culture shock with his own people, which is a lot. And from someone who has gone to PWIs my whole life, predominantly white schools, when I graduated and I went to other colleges that my cousins went to and their graduations at HBCUs, I felt like I was cheated. I felt like I missed out on so much as an individual with my own people. And, you know, that's just a totally different video. I'll have to make a totally different video about the misconceptions about HBCUs, because I had counselors. Now that I'm older, I realize, like, wow, that was really racist. Things that they would tell me about HBCUs. You don't want to go there. You have a 4.2. You have a cumulative of a 4.1. That's a totally different video. I have to do a totally different video about that. But anyway, that scene was very deep. Because are we pressuring young kids? You have to go to college. You have to do this. This is the formality and the timeline of your life. But that scene in his confusion was just like, wow, you're getting into Harvard. Okay, you're going to Harvard to do blank, to do what? And Micah has that moment of, is he embarrassed? Is he even more confused now? Kiki had a look of, dang, he don't know what he want to do. And his friends was just like, wow. It was that moment of silence and confusion, and that the friends were just kind of shocked that he didn't know what he wanted to do. Very, very deep. And it's interesting to know will Micah's character collapse because he's unsure of himself?
Whoop, whoop, that's how some of that proceeds.
And she's like, you're gonna need some ammunition. And she hands her a book. And it's the same book that the distant cousin gives to Nova. Foreshadowing. This is foreshadowing. So she says the word ammunition. And I know y'all are like, okay, you looking too deep into this. But look, you have to go into the writing. And this is how I predict a lot of stuff. She says, here is some ammunition that you can use. Now, keep in mind, generally in writing, when they say ammunition, ammunition is highly likely to backfire. It seems like a wonderful idea and something that you can have and use, but playing dirty always gets your hands dirty. You always get dirty dealing with dirt. So as the viewer, you know, we're thinking, yay, this is something she can use, you know, to finally use on the Landry's. Yeah, let's go for it. Don't get too crunk yet, because I have a feeling that this will unfortunately backfire.